Our call to worship comes from Psalm 17, reading the first three verses. Hear me, Lord, my plea is just. Listen to my cry. Hear my prayer. It does not rise from deceitful lips. Let my vindication come from you. May your eyes see what is right. Though you probe my heart, though you examine me at night and test me, you will find that I have planned no evil. My mouth has not transgressed. Let us respond to that call to worship in joining together and praising the Lord. Shall we gather at the river?
Shall we gather at the river, where bright angel feet have trod, with its crystal tide forever flowing by the throne of God? Yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful, beautiful gather with the saints at the river that flows by the throne of God. Soon we'll reach the shining river, soon our pilgrimage will cease. Soon our happy hearts will quiver with the melody of peace. And yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful, beautiful river, gather with the saints at the river that flows by the throne of God.
Hey, Gordon, play one now.
On the margin of the river, washing up its silver spray, we will walk and worship ever all the happy golden day. And yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful, beautiful river, gather with the saints at the river that flows by the throne of God. Oh, and yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful, beautiful river, gather with the saints at the river that flows by the throne of God, that flows by the throne of God, that flows by the throne of God.
A very good morning to each and every one of you. I greet you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and I wish to welcome you to our service this morning. We have gathered to praise and worship and become silent at the foot of the cross. I truly hope and trust and pray that you will be blessed by our service today. Before we commence, may I just inquire on how you are doing? Are you still coping? And are you still healthy and are you safe? My prayer for you today is that God will still continue his journey with you and that you will just reach out to him as we continue the frustrations of this lockdown. But you know what? We're going to have a great time this morning as we worship the Lord, as we praise the Lord. And as you can have already heard, what a wonderful song it was to start, "Shall We Gather by the River." Let us continue this morning and let us praise the Lord. Let us worship him. A little bit more upbeat music. You know, we serve an awesome God, a God that is good all the time. There's been very many theological debates on whether there's any bad in God. And you know, there is nothing that is bad in God. He is good all the time. We're going to do "God is Good All the Time," and it's going to go directly into "Celebrate Jesus." So let us join together in singing.
God is good all the time. Put a song of praise in this heart of mine. God is good all the time. Through the darkest night, his light will shine. God is good all the time. God is good all the time. He put a song of praise in this heart of mine. God is good all the time. Through the darkest night, his light will shine. God is good. God is good all the time. If you walk through the valley and there's shadows all around, do not fear, he will guide you, he will keep you safe and sound. He has promised to never leave you nor forsake you, and his word is true. God is good all the time. He put a song of praise in this heart of mine. God is good all the time. Through the darkest night, his light will shine. God is good. God is good all the time. We were sinners, so unworthy, still for us he chose to die. Filled us with his Holy Spirit, now we can stand and testify that his love is everlasting and his mercies, they will never end. God is good all the time. Put a song of praise in this heart of mine. God is good all the time. Through the darkest night, his light will shine. God is good. God is good all the time. Though I may not understand all the plans you have for me, my life is in your hands, and through the eyes of faith I can clearly see that God is good all the time. Put a song of praise in this heart of mine. God is good all the time. Through the darkest night, his light will shine. God is good. He is so good. God is good. God is good.
a song of praise as we gather here. Celebrate the Lord of love. Jesus is our Lord. He is reigning here. We declare His kingdom's come. Darkness has to flee in His holy light. Celebrate the Lord of love. All creation sing. Oceans roar, let the earth proclaim that Christ is Lord.
Let the earth proclaim Him, let the earth proclaim
Him.
Trade your heavy heart for a heart of joy. Celebrate what God has done. Join the song of praise as we gather here. Celebrate the Lord of
Jesus is our Lord.
Jesus is our Lord. Is reigning here. We declare His kingdom's come. Darkness has to flee in His holy light. Celebrate the Lord of love. All creation sings. Hear the oceans roar. Let the earth proclaim that Christ is Lord.
Let us praise the Lord. Let us pray to Him. Come, let us join together in prayer. Most gracious and heavenly Father, Lord, we greet You this morning as we've gathered about You as Your people, as Your children, Lord God, to praise You and to worship You and just to become silent at Your feet. Oh Lord, we pray that You will meet with us as a church this morning. And we pray, Lord, that You will touch each and every one of us. O Lord, we bow to You this morning. We bow our heads and bend our knees because You are the God of God and the Lord of Lords. And it is You that we worship this morning. O dear Lord Jesus, we just want to worship You because You are our King. You are our Redeemer. It is with Your life that You paid the price for each and every one of us. But Lord, You sent us Your Holy Spirit to dwell within us, who is our guider and who is our friend. And Holy Spirit, we greet You too this morning, although You are with us all the time. Very little do we stop to listen to You. Very little do we stop to talk with You. But this morning, we just want to be with our triune God. Just praise you and worship you, give you all the honor and the glory. But Lord, we know that as we come to your throne, we know that in a week gone by we have sinned against you, and we need to come clean, Lord, because it is you that promised and said, if we turn from our wicked ways and repent, you will forgive us. So, Lord, in our silence right now, we want to empty our hearts before you. So, Lord, hear our personal and individual confessions as we empty our hearts now. O dear Lord God, you have heard our hearts, you have heard our plea, you have heard our cry to please forgive our sins. All those that we've confessed, and even those, Lord, that we do as a second nature and we don't even realize we are sinning anymore because we've become so comfortable around sin. So, Lord, we pray that you will forgive us. And, Lord, we know that you've given us that assurance of forgiveness in your scriptures. So many places you've promised, Lord, and we know that your promises are true and that they are just, and that you are faithful in giving us our forgiveness. Oh Lord, you don't just forgive, but you justify us as though we've never committed that sin. And therefore, Lord, we praise you and we worship you and we say thank you, Lord, for being a wonderful God, a God of love, and a God that constantly forgives, and a God that constantly justifies each and every one of us. Thank you, Lord, for this wonderful privilege that we have, that we can come unto you in the name of Jesus to atone for all our sins. Oh, Father, as we continue now with our service, we just want to pray that you will be with each and every one of us and that you will touch us, and that you will bless us. So, Lord, we thank you. In the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Come, let us grab our Bibles. Let us delve into the Word of God. Today we're going to be reading about Esau and Jacob. Do you all remember that story? And the passage we have today is such a wonderful passage. So grab your Bibles. Let's read together. Our reading today is taken from Genesis chapter 32, verses 22 to 31. That night Jacob got up and took his two wives, his two female servants, and his 11 sons, and crossed the ford at the Jabbok. After he had sent them across the stream, he sent over all his possessions. So Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him till daybreak. When the man saw that he could not overpower him, he touched the socket of Jacob's heap, so that his heap was wrenched as he wrestled with a man. Then the man said, "Let me go, for it is daybreak." But Jacob replied, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." The man asked him, "What is your name?" "Jacob," he answered. Then the man said, "Your name will no longer be Jacob, but Israel, because you have struggled with God and with humans and have overcome." Jacob said, "Please tell me your name." But he replied, "Why do you ask my name?" Then he blessed him there. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, "It is because I saw God face to face, and yet my life was spared." The sun rose above him as he passed Peniel, and he was limping because of his hip. Let us ask God to enlighten our minds so that we can understand his scriptures, understand his message to us today. So come, let us pray. Almighty, gracious and loving Father, Lord, we have gathered to hear your word to us, to hear your message to us. So Lord, we pray that you will just touch our hearts and touch our minds, so that we may hear you, Lord, and hear what it is that you have to say to us. But Lord, as you speak to us, and as you touch our hearts and our minds, let us take what you say, and let us make it part of our lives, so that truly we may understand and live our life accordingly. So Lord, hold us tightly, draw us close to you, so that we can hear. And Lord, as I bring your message to these your people, I pray, Lord, that you will use me as an instrument of communication, and that your Holy Spirit will take total control of me, and that all the words and the meditations that may flow from my lips will be yours, Lord, and that they will bring you honor and glory at all times. So, Lord, we pray. Draw us close to you, in Jesus' name.
Help me know you.
I am sure we all know the story of Esau and Jacob, and we know how Jacob and his mother Rebekah cheated Esau, cheated his father Isaac, so that he could get the birthright of Isaac. So today we look at this, and we all know the story on how Jacob fled, and to try and calm his brother down, he left the family, he left the house, and he moved to a place known as Paramaran, where he went to stay for a couple of years, and where he worked, and how he established himself into being quite a great farmer. But we all know that Jacob was quite a coward, and he always let other people do everything, as he did not want to be in the front lines of anything. It meant business, it meant with his brother Esau, because of what he had done. And he always looked back over his shoulder, always wondering when his brother might come, Esau. And when Esau came, he always thought that Esau might have a revenge or plot a revenge against him. But as he goes, Jacob realizes what he has done. And he knows that he has cheated his mother, his brother, and together with his mother urges him to flee. But in the state of fleeing and getting away from Esau, and being away from home, and being in this foreign area or foreign town or Paranaran, he comes to realize that he cannot make it on his own, and that he needs God, and he needs God on his side. And God meets with him, and God says to him that I will always be with you. You need not fear. So despite what Jacob had done, God had still gone with him to wherever he went. And we see it reaches a point, and I believe, I know the scriptures don't put it in so many words, but I believe it is God that had said to him, it's time to come back, it's time to go and face your problem, which was Esau. And God leads him back to be where Esau is. Now remember, in the time that Jacob was away, he became quite a wealthy man. He became a man that possessed quite a lot of animals. He had a big piece of ground in Paddan Aram. And now he had to come back, this powerful man. But coming back to Esau, he also knew that Esau was a powerful man as well. So in his time of being away from his brother Esau, God, I believe, led him on a path, because we see how he was cheated, and through his father-in-law Laban, where he actually wanted and was in love with Rachel, and how his father or his father-in-law cheated him and gave him Leah. But then he promised his father-in-law that he would keep Leah, but that he would also marry Rachel. So we read, when he comes to the river on his way back, going to go and face Esau, that God had put him through trials and tribulations, and that he had gone through that. But remember that God is with him all the time, and that he is continuing his struggle, because this is the biggest hurdle that he has to come, and that is to face Esau. But he comes to the river, the Jabbok, and he sends his wife. He first sends his concubines, and he sends his slaves, and then he sends through Leah and her children, and then Rachel and Joseph. But there was a big change in Jacob as he goes on. But by him sending his wives and concubines first, he was in the back. In other words, again, he displays a little bit of his cowardice by sending through his wife, so that if there is any danger, they would hit it dead on, and they would get it first. And then he would most probably, and please, this is speculation, if this happened to his wives, he would then have to flee and get out of the area. But he sends them through, and then he stays behind alone on this side of the Jabbok. And that night, in a dream, he meets a man with whom he wrestles. Now, I believe this is God that has come, and it says a man. Others believe theologically this is an angel that has come to meet with him. But I believe it is God that came in the form of a man. Now, just remember that God cannot and is not as small as a man, but a part of him that meets with Jacob. And they wrestled the whole night long. Now, it says when it got to daybreak, the man says to Jacob, "Leave me and I must go because it is daybreak." But Jacob clings to him and he does not let him go. And it is in this wrestling that the man, whom I believe is God, touches his hip and he becomes paralyzed to a certain extent, so much so that he walks with a wobble or a limp. And as he walks on limping, but Jacob still clings. And Jacob says, "I will not let you go until you bless me. Until you bless me." And I believe, yeah, that Jacob knew that he was wrestling with God himself. And that's why he does not want to let him go. And that's why he asks God for his blessing. I think just to stop there for a little while, if you were wrestling with God and what would you ask God? Would you ask him to bless you? Or would we with our ulterior motive say, "God, don't you please want to give me an army so that I can go and conquer my brother so that I can be the strong one and go back and show?" No, but he asks God to bless him. And then God asks him, or the man asks him, "What is your name?" And Jacob answers, he says, "My name is Jacob." The man says to Jacob, "Your name will no longer be Jacob, but it would from now on be Israel." You may say, "John, what is in a name?" Now we must remember that Jacob and Esau were twins. And Esau was born first, but when Esau was born coming out of his mother's womb, Jacob was holding onto the heel of Esau. And that's what it actually means. That Jacob was the heel biter, holder, call it whatever you want, but he was born second, holding onto the heel of Esau. But God changes his name from that. And we know that Jacob was deceitful and that he went through his whole life being deceitful. But God yet changes him. Changes him and he changes his name to Israel, which means face to face with God or wrestling with God and struggling with God. And, you know, I believe God did this for a certain reason, because for his whole life when Jacob left home, he was struggling. He was struggling with what he did. He was struggling with life. He was struggling to get his real wife. He was struggling everywhere. And lastly, Yeri struggles with God. And God touches him, and God then leaves him there as a man with a limp. The significance of the limp we will get to a bit later, but I just want to stop there a little while. I want to say to you, folks, sometimes in life there are things that we do that are not right. There are things that we do that are dishonest. There are things that we do that are harmful to others. And whenever we do that, we always rather try and flee than trying to rectify the situation. When you've lied to somebody or been deceitful to somebody, you actually get out of the way when you see that person coming, because you don't want that person to confront you, because you're scared that that person He's going to do something to you. He's going to seek revenge. And that's why we rather try and keep our distance from people that we've been deceitful with, people that we lie to, people that we haven't treated properly, people that we've perhaps hurt. But the problem is when we, can I use the term, when we run away from those people that we've hurt, when we run away from them, we constantly have to look over our shoulders. Not so. We constantly have to look, is that guy not behind us? Is that woman not behind us? Are those people not behind us? Are they not in front of us? Are they not to our left or to our right? And we are constantly on the outlook for those people. And you know, it puts us into to such an emotional state that eventually we can't live our life with the freedom that we have. And everything in life becomes a struggle because we can't live our life freely. We find that it inhibits us, it prohibits us. You know, there's a saying that if you can't trust yourself, you cannot trust other people. So when we've been deceitful, when we've been dishonest, or when we've hurt somebody, we know that we can't trust ourselves because of what we have done. And then when we can't start trusting people, we cannot build relationships. And when we can't build relationships, wow, that's mighty loneful. And we become so lonely that we have no quality of life. So this morning I'm trying to say to you that, you know, running away from our problems is the last thing we must do. We must never run away from our problems, but rather we must take them head on. That wonderful idiom, we must take the bull by the horns. And we must wrestle it and we must struggle it. And I think, and please, this is not biblical, but I think, yeah, that this is Jacob. And I think this is why God loved Jacob so much, is because Jacob struggled with these problems until he came to the point where he wrestled with God, he struggled with God. And we see a remarkable change in Jacob after that wrestling. The first change we see that is as they continued through the desert and as they continued to proceed towards Isaac, towards Esau, Jacob no longer was behind his concubines and his slaves and his children. He was no longer at the back of Leah or Rachel, but he was right in front. So we see that through God's grace and through God's leading and through God's prompting, that the very next day after this wrestling, Jacob was right in front because he knew that God was with him. He knew that that night when he had wrestled with God, he had got forgiveness by God. And that's why he could head on and go to his brother and take him and speak to him. But what's wonderful here is that when God wrestles with him and he becomes crippled, what does he do? Jacob knows that now, as a man, man to man, he could not take Esau on. So he could not be deceitful. He could not come and say that he wanted to take him on and seek revenge, because in a man to man brawl with his brother, he would lose. Because he was limping and because God had touched his hip and made him a little bit crippled. So you see, what needed to happen here by God and what God does to Jacob is when he makes him crippled, he makes him a little bit of an invalid, Jacob is forced to become humble. When he goes to his brother, he's got to be humbled. You know what happens? The greatest thing happens as he continues. What he does, he sends gifts to Esau. He sends gifts of animals, sheep and goats and donkeys and cattle. And he sends this as a type of a peacemaker. Now you can just imagine Esau becoming a powerful man himself, and here comes his brother. And when he sees him coming limping, he knows that Jacob is no match for him. But But what does Esau do? Esau responds in such a manner that he is able to forgive him through the humility of Jacob. And also, the scriptures say to us that God touches the heart of Esau. And with that great, wonderful power of God, love is instilled between Jacob and Esau. And when Jacob and Esau get together, I can only imagine the happiness, the wonderful celebration between two brothers, twin brothers, that when they see, they get together and Esau hugs his brother and they are reconciled to one another. Folks, what a wonderful narrative, what a wonderful story about Jacob and Esau. And I know when we read the beginning part where Jacob cheated his brother and cheated his father, we all got angry. But you know what? Despite that, God forgave Jacob. God forgave Esau. And he loved both of them so much that he brought them together. So there's two main components in this message this morning that I wanted to share with you. And the first one is, and I've already mentioned it, is when we've done something wrong, ask God for forgiveness, go back and ask the person that you have harmed or that you've lied to or that you've been deceitful to, go and ask them for forgiveness. No matter how they respond, no matter what they do, but you know that in God's eyes, you have done correctly. And you know what? Chances are very good that God is going to touch the heart of that person so that they will receive you and that your relationship can be mended once again. And secondly, no matter what you do, and I've mentioned this in very many of my sermons, no matter what you've done, no matter how deceitful you've been, no matter how you've harmed people, no matter how unloving you've been, remember I told you the story of my teacher Volley that God forgave, but no matter what you've done, God will be with you. He doesn't turn his back with you. Before Jacob asks for forgiveness, God goes with him, doesn't he? And God gives him the assurance that he's with him. And when Jacob does ask for forgiveness, and when Jacob does struggle with God, God doesn't leave him or run away, but God wrestles with him, God teaches him, God leads him, God guides him. So no matter what you've done in your life, no matter how bad you are, no matter how bad you think you are, no matter how depressed you are, no matter how big a sinner you are, God will never leave you nor forsake you. He is with you always. So many people say to me, John, I'm not worthy. Well, all of us are not worthy. But you know, despite our unworthiness, that is why Jesus came to this earth. Is he came for the sinner so that he can come and save him and set him free from the bondage of sin. So folks, this morning I want to urge you to reconcile with everybody that you've hurt or people that have hurt you. And in this time of sin, God has never abandoned you. He has loved you. Turn to him. Ask him to forgive you. And you know what? Just be reconciled to God first, and God will set the scene, no matter what the circumstance may be. He will go with you. He will touch the other person's heart, and he will bring reconciliation with whoever you have a problem. But do this in humility, and do it in the name of Almighty God, in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Come, let us respond to that word of God in prayer. Come, let us pray. Gracious Lord, we thank you for that message this morning. Thank you for your word to us. Thank you, Lord, for helping us. Thank you, Lord, for loving us. And thank you, Lord, for never, ever forsaking us and leaving us alone. But Lord, as we go into this world, Lord, give us the strength and the courage to go to those that we have hurt, or those that we've deceived, or those that we've been untruthful to, those that have something against us. Help us, Lord, give us that courage to go and ask for forgiveness, that we may be reconciled with them. And yes, Lord, if they do not respond to us, let us go knowing that you are going with us and that we are doing our duty as you expect us to do that. Oh Lord, also we pray that as we go to those people that have something against us, that you will just touch their hearts so that truly we may be reunited once again. Oh Lord, we thank you that you never leave us and that you never forsake us. We thank you, Lord, that you're a God of love and that you're a God that forgives and that you're a God that is with us all the time. So, Lord, through your Holy Spirit, we pray that you will touch us and that you will prompt us and encourage us to go to these people and to reconcile. Help us, Lord, to ask you for forgiveness in everything that we've done. Help us, Lord, to know and show us what we've done too, Lord, so that we may know and ask you for forgiveness before we go. Oh Lord, we thank you for this wonderful opportunity, for this wonderful time that we can go in your name and we can go and confront these people and ask for forgiveness and ask that we may be reconciled. We thank you, Lord, that you instill in us a heart of love, that you've given us your love so that we can go and be with these people. Thank you, Lord, for being our God. Yes, Lord, and thank you for being with us 24/7, no matter what. And, oh Lord, as we start a new week, we pray for your blessing. We pray for your guidance, Lord, that you will be with us, that you will guide us and protect us. Oh Lord, we've become so frustrated with this lockdown. And Lord, therefore, we pray that you will just hold us tightly and that you will grant us your peace and your love so that we may be content during this time. Oh Lord, we pray that you take away these frustrations. And we also pray for our country, Lord, that you may just bring healing and that you will just sort out this virus so that we can once again live our life as you want us and intend us to live. So, Lord, we thank you and we praise you in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Let us conclude our service by singing that wonderful song, Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. For indeed, do not let any sin keep you or become a yoke around your neck. Ask for that forgiveness, and then we can proclaim it that our chains are gone and we are free to serve Almighty God.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. grace that taught
my heart to hear and raise my fear. How precious in that grace of me, the hour I first believed.
My chains are gone.
Receive the blessing. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, here now today, and forevermore. Amen. And may God bless you with his richest blessing until we meet again. Folks, our time has come to an end. Yes, again it has seemed so short for me, but it was an honor and a privilege to come into your homes and share the Word of God with you. As I leave this morning, I just want to say to each and every one of you that you are a very, very special person and that God loves you very, very much. And never, ever forget that. No matter what happens, God loves you. So until we meet again, stay safe, stay healthy, and always remember that God is there for you. No matter what happens, just reach out to Him and He will help you. So until we meet again, goodbye now.
May the road rise to meet you. May the wind be at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face. May the rain fall softly on your fields, and until we meet again, may you keep safe in the gentle loving arms of God.
For everything there is a season, a time for meeting, a time to say goodbye. In all things God's near, always guiding your way.
To meet you, may the wind be at your back, may the sun shine warm upon your face, upon your face. May the rain fall softly on your fields, and until we meet again, may you safe in the gentle loving arms of God.
For everything there is a season, a time for laughter, a time for tears and pain. In all things God is near, always guiding your
the wind be at your back.
May the sun shine warm upon your face.
May the rain fall softly on your fields,
and until we meet again, may you keep safe in the gentle